fickle crew have deserted Reginald and sworn allegiance to his rival, and all, forsooth, because he has glanced with passing favour on a puling milkmaid. Fools! Of that fancy he will soon weary, and then I, who alone am faithful to him, shall reap my reward. But do not dally too long, Reginald, for my charms are ripe, Reginald, and already they are decaying. Better secure me ere I have gone too far. Beauties disappear. When time grew weary of her heart torn sighs, impatiently begins to dim her eyes. In life's uncertain gloamings, to wreathe her wrinkled brow with well-saved combings, reduced with rouge, lips all, and pearly grey, to make up for lost time as best she may. goodbye.
Love me, and yet how hopelessly. Ah, patience, patience, with the love of thee in my heart, what have I for these poor mad maidens but an unvalued pity? Alas, they will die of hopeless love for me, as I shall die of hopeless love for thee.
Sir, would it please you to read to us?
Yes, child. If you will, what shall I read?
One of your own poems.
One of my own poems? Better not, my child. They will not cure thee of thy love.
Mr. Bunthorne used to read us a poem of his own every day.
And, to do him justice, he read them extremely well.
Oh! Did he, sir? Well, who am I to take upon myself to withhold my gift from you? What am I but a trustee? Here is a decollet, a pure and simple thing, a very daisy. A babe might understand it. To appreciate it, it is not necessary to think of anything at all.
Well, let us think of nothing at all.
Gentle Jane was as good as gold. She always did what she was told. She never spoke when her mouth was full, or caught blue bottles, their legs to pull, or spilt plum jam on her nice new frock, or put white mice in the 8-day clock, or vivisected her last new doll, or fostered a passion for alcohol. And when she grew up, she was given in marriage to a first-class earl who keeps his carriage. I believe there is not one word in that decollete that is calculated to bring the blush of shame to the cheek of modesty.
Not one.
No, no, not one. It is purity itself.
Here is another. Teasing Tom was a very bad boy. A great big squirt was his favourite toy. He put live shrimps in his father's boots and sewed up the sleeves of his Sunday suits. He punched his poor little sister's heads and cayenne-peppered their four-post beds. He plastered their hair with cobbler's wax and dropped hot hickories down their backs. The consequence was he was lost totally and married a girl in the court of Valet!
Mark you, how grandly, how relentlessly the damning catalogue of crime strode on until retribution, like a poison hawk, swooped down upon the wrongdoer. Oh, it was terrible!
Yes.
Oh, sir,
you are indeed a true poet, for you touch our hearts, and they go out to you.
This is simply cloying. Ladies, I am sorry to appear ungallant, but this is Saturday, and you've been following me round ever since Monday. I should like the usual half holiday. I should take it as a personal favour if you would kindly allow me to close early. Today.
Oh, sir! Do not send us from here!
Poor, poor girls. It is best to speak plainly. I know that I am loved by you, but I can never love you in return, for my heart is fixed elsewhere. Remember the fable of the magnet and the churn.
But we don't know the fable of the magnet and the churn.
Don't you? Then I'll sing it to you. Magnet hung in a hardware shop, and all around is a alarming crop of scissors and needles, nails and knives, offering love for all their lives. But I and the magnet felt no win, though it charmed I, and it charmed not him. From needles and nails and knives he turned, for it set his love on a silver churn.
A silver churn!
A silver churn. Was this aesthetic, very magnetic, fancy took his turn. If I can riddle a knife or a needle, why not a silver churn?
If Bruce's aesthetic, very magnetic, fancy took his turn. If I can riddle a knife or a needle, why not a silver churn?
And iron and steel expressed surprise. The needles opened their well-drilled eyes. The penknives held shut up, no doubt. The scissors declared themselves cut out. The kettles they boiled with rage to set, while every nail went off its head. And hither and thither began to roll, till the hammer came up and drove them home.
It drove them home.
It drove them home. Was this magnetic, magnetic lover he lived to learn? By no endeavor can magnet ever attract a silver churn.
While this magnetic, magnetic lover he lived to learn, by no endeavor can magnet ever attract a silver churn.
Lost, they are gone. What is this mysterious fascination I seem to exercise over all I come across? Or a curse on my fatal beauty? For I am sick of conquests.
Archibald!
Patience!
I have escaped, with difficulty, from my Reginald. I wanted to see you so much that I might ask if you still love me as fondly as ever.
Love you? It's the devotion of a lifetime!
Hold! Unhand me or I'll scream! Sir, if you are a gentleman, pray remember that I am another's. But you do love me, don't you?
Madly, hopelessly, despairingly.
That's right. I never can be yours, but that's right.
And you love this Bunthorne?
With a heart whole ecstasy that withers and scorches and burns and stings. It is my duty.
Admirable girl. But you are not happy with him.
Happy? I am miserable, beyond description.
That's right. I never can be yours, but that's right.
We'll go now. I see dear Reginald approaching. Farewell, Archibald. I cannot tell you how happy it makes me to know that you still love me.
If I only dared...
Sir, this language to one who is promised to another. Think of me sometimes, for my heart is breaking. He is so unkind to me. And you would be so loving.
Oh, loving!
Advance one step, and as I am a good and pure woman, I scream! Farewell, Archibald. Stop there. Think of me sometimes. Advance at your peril. Huh? Once more, adieu.
Crying, eh? What are you crying about?
I was only thinking how dearly I love you.
Love me? Bah!
Love him? Bah!
Don't you interfere!
He always crushes me. What is the matter, dear Reginald? If you have any sorrow, pray tell it to me so that I may share it with you. It is my duty.
Whom were you talking with just now?
With dear Archibald.
Dear Archibald.
Upon my honour, this is too much!
A great deal too much!
Will you be quiet?
Crushed again! I think he is the noblest, purest, most perfect being I have ever met. But I don't love him. It is true he is devotedly attached to me, but I don't love him. Whenever he grows affectionate, I scream.
I dare say.
So do I. I dare say.
Shh.
Well, how could I love him and you at the same time? You can't love two people at once.
And can't you, then?
No, you can't. I only wish you could.
I don't believe you know what love is.
Yes, I do! There was a happy time when I didn't. But a bitter experience has taught me. Sung by a suffering maid, telling a tale of wrong, telling of hope betrayed, tuned to each changing note, sighing.
Everything has gone wrong with me since that smug-faced idiot came here. Before that, I was admired. I may say loved.
The two not adore.
Do let a poet soliloquize. The damosels used to follow me wherever I went. Now they all follow him.
Not all. I am still faithful to you.
Yes, and a pretty damosel you are.
No, not pretty. Massive. Oh, cheer up. I'll never leave you, I swear it.
Oh, thank you. I know what it is. It's his confounded mildness. They find me too highly spiced, if you please. And no doubt I am highly spiced.
Not for my taste.
No, but I am for theirs. I'll show the world that I can be as mild as he. If it's insipidity they want, they shall have it. I shall meet this fellow on his own ground. Beat him on it.
You shall, and I shall help you.
You will? Jane, there's a good deal of good in you after all.
And say to him with compliment ironical,
say hey to you, good day to you, that's what I shall say.
Your style is much too sanctified, your cut is too canonical.
Say bar to you, ha ha to you, and that's what I shall say.
I was the mere ideal of the morbid young receptacle. To doubt my inspiration was regarded as heretical, until you cut me off with your acidity emetical.
Say poo to you, poo poo to you, and that's what I shall say. Sing boo to you, poo poo to you, and that's what I shall say.
Sing hey to you, good day to you, sing bo to you, ha ha to you, sing bo to you, good poo to you, and that's what I shall say. Sing hey to you, good day to you, sing bo to you, ha ha to you, sing bo to you, and that's what I shall say. Boo, boo,
and that's what I shall say. Ba, ba, and that's what I shall say. Tell him that unless he will consent to be more jocular,
sing boo to you, boo boo to you, and that's what you should say.
To cut his curly hair and stick an eyeglass in his ocular,
sing bar to you, ha ha to you, and that's what you should say.
To stuff his conversation full of quibble and of quiddity, to dine on chops and roly-poly pudding with avidity, he'd better clear away with all convenient rapidity.
Sing hey, good day to you, and that's what you should say.
Sing boo to you, poo poo to you, and that's what I shall say.
Sing hey to you, good day to you, sing ba to you, ha ha to you, sing bo to you, poo poo to you, and that's what you should say. Sing hey to you, good day to you, sing ba to you, ha ha to you, sing bo to you, and that's what you should say. Ba, ba, and that's what you should say.
Ba, ba,
and that's what you should say.
We're not quite sure if all we do has the early English ring, but as far as we can judge, it's something like this sort of thing. You hold yourself like this, you hold yourself like that. By look and crook, you try to look both angular and flat. We venture to expect that what we recollect, though but a part of true high art, will have its due effect. this is not exactly right. We hope you won't upbraid. You can't get time, aesthetic taste, like trousers ready made. True views on medievalism, time alone will bring. But as far as we can judge, it's something like this sort of thing. You hold yourself like this. You hold yourself like that. By hook and crook, you try to look both angular and flat. To cultivate the trim rigidity of him, you ought to get a manualist and form your style on him.
Quite clear that our only chance of making a lasting impression upon these young ladies is to become as aesthetic as they are.
No doubt. The only question is how far we've succeeded in doing so. I don't know why, but I've an idea that this is not quite right.
I don't like it. I never did. I don't see what it means. I do it, but I don't like it.
My good sir, the question is not whether we like it, but whether they do. They understand these things. We don't. Now, I shouldn't be surprised if this was effective enough. At a distance.
I can't help thinking we're a little stiff at it. It would be extremely awkward if we were to be struck so.
I don't think we shall be struck so. Perhaps a little awkward at first, but everything must have a beginning, you know. Oh, here they come! Attention!
Oh, Sophia, see! See! Oh, the immortal fire has descended, and they are off the inner brotherhood, perceptively intense and consummately utter!
Oh, how Fra Angelicum! How Botticellian! Oh, Art, we thank thee for this boon.
I'm afraid we're not quite right.
Oh, not supremely, but oh, so all but. Oh, Sophia, are they not quite too all but?
Oh, indeed, they are jolly utter.
I wonder what the inner brotherhood would usually recommend.
Cram.
Ladies, we will not deceive you. We are doing this at some personal inconvenience with a view of expressing the extremity of our devotion to you. We trust that it is not without its effect.
We will not deny that we are much moved by this proof of your affection.
Indeed, your conversion to the principles of aesthetic art and its highest development has touched us deeply.
And if Mr. Grosvenor should remain obdurate,
which we have every reason to believe he will,
we are not prepared to say that our yearning hearts will not go out to you.
By sections of three, rapture!
Oh, oh, it's very good. For beginners, it's admirable.
The only question is, who will take who?
Oh. Oh, the Duke chooses first, as matter of course.
Oh, I couldn't think of it. You really are too good.
Oh, not at all. Oh. You are a great matrimonial fish. And it is only fair that each of these ladies should have a chance of hooking you.
If Sophia choose to marry, I shall be fixed up for life. Then the colonel need not tarry, Angela can be his wife.
In the case of precedent, it's single, I must live and die. I will have to be contented with a heartfelt sympathy.
He will have to be contented with a heartfelt sympathy. In the case of precedent, it's single, I must live and die. He will have to be contented with a heartfelt sympathy. He will have to be contented with a heartfelt sympathy. He will have to be contented with a heartfelt sympathy.
If on Angie I determine at my wedding she'll appear decked in diamond and ermine, Major then can take Saphir.
In that case unprecedented single I shall live and die. I shall have to be contented with a heartfelt sympathy.
He will have to be contented with a heartfelt sympathy. In that case unprecedented single I will live and die. I will have to be contented with a heartfelt sympathy. I will have to be contented with a heartfelt sympathy. I will have to be contented with a heartfelt sympathy.
After much debate internal, if on neither I decide, Saphir then can take the colonel, and she be the major's bride. In that case, unprecedented single, I must live and die. I shall have to be contented with their heartfelt sympathy.
He will have to be contented with a heartfelt sympathy. In that case unprecedented single, I will live and die. I will have to be contented with a heartless sympathy. I will have to be contented with a heartless sympathy. I will have to be contented with a heart.
Very pleasant to be alone. It is pleasant to be able to gaze upon those features which all others may gaze upon at their goodwill. I am a very narcissus. Ah, it's useless. I cannot live without admiration. Since Grosvenor came here, insipidity has been at a premium. He is there. Ah, Bunthorne, come here, look. Very graceful, isn't it?
Allow me. I haven't seen it. Why, yes, it is graceful.
Good gracious, not that. This.
Don't mean that. But I'm in no mood for trifling.
And what's amiss?
Ever since you came here, you have entirely monopolized the attentions of the young ladies. I don't like it, sir!
My dear sir, how can I help it? They are the plague of my life! My dear Mr. Bunthorne, with your personal disadvantages, you can have no idea of the inconvenience of being madly loved at first sight by every woman you meet.
Sir, before you came here, I was adored.
Exactly! Before I came here, that's my grievance. I cut everybody out. I can assure you that if you could only suggest some means whereby, consistently with my duty to society, that I could escape these inconvenient attentions, you would earn my everlasting gratitude.
I will do so at once. However popular it may be with the outside world, your personal appearance is highly objectionable to me.
It is? Oh, thank you, thank you. How can I express my gratitude?
By making a complete change at once. Your conversation must henceforth be perfectly matter of fact. You must cut your hair and have a back party.
I have to beg pardon?
Back party! In appearance and costume, you must be entirely commonplace.
No, pardon me, but that's impossible.
Take care. When I am thwarted, I am very terrible.
Oh, I can't help that. I am a man on a mission, and that mission must be fulfilled.
I don't think you quite appreciate the consequences of thwarting me.
Oh, I don't care what they are.
Suppose, I won't go so far as to say that I would do it, but suppose I were to curse you. Take care.
But surely you would never do that.
I don't know. It would be an extreme measure, no doubt. Still.
But you would not do it. I'm sure you would not. Oh, reflect. Reflect. You had a mother once.
Never.
Then you had an aunt.
Auntie.
I see that you had. Now, by the memory of that aunt, I urge you to pause. Hey, you resort to this last fearful experience. Oh, Mr. Bunthorne, reflect! Reflect!
I must not allow myself to be unmanned. It is useless. Consent at once, or may a nephew's curse...
Hold! Are you absolutely resolved?
Absolutely.
But will nothing shake you?
Nothing. I am adamant.
Oh, very well. Then I yield.
Do you swear it?
Oh, I do. Cheerfully. I've long wished for a reasonable pretext for such a change as you suggest. It has come at last. I do it on compulsion.
Victory! I triumph!
When I go out the door, damosels a score, all sighing and burning and clinging and yearning will follow me as before. I shall with cultured taste distinguish gems from paste, and hey diddle diddle will rank as a niddle if I pronounce it chaste.
A most intense young man, a soulful eye young man, an ultra poetical, super aesthetical, out of the way young man. Conceive me if you can, an everyday young man, a commonplace type with a stick and a pipe and a half-bred black and tan, who thinks suburban hops more fun than Monday pops, who's fond of his dinner and doesn't get thinner on bottled beer and chops. A commonplace young man, a matter-of-fact young man, a steady and stolidly jolly bank holiday everyday young man.
A Japanese young man, a blue and white young man, Francesca de Rimini, Mimini, Pimini, je ne sais quoi, young man.
A Chancery Lane young man, a Somerset House young man, a very delectable, highly respectable, thrifty bus young man.
A pallid and thin young man, a haggard and lank young man, a greenery, yellery, Grosvenor gallery, foot in the grave young man.
A Sewell and Cross young man, a Howard and James young man, a pushing young particle, what's the next article, Waterloo House young man. Conceive me if you can, a matter of fact young man, an alphabetical, arithmetical, everyday young man. Conceive me if you can, a matter of fact young man, an alphabetical, arithmetical, everyday young man.
It is all right. I have committed my last act of ill nature, and henceforth I am a changed character.
Reginald? What's this? Dancing? And
patience.
What in the world is the matter with you?
I'm a changed man. Hitherto I've been gloomy, moody, fitful, uncertain in temper, and selfish in disposition.
You have indeed.
All that is changed. I have reformed. I have modelled myself on Mr. Grosvenor. Henceforth, I am mildly cheerful. My conversation will blend instruction with amusement. I shall still be aesthetic, but my aestheticism will be of the most pastoral kind.
Oh, Reginald, is all this true?
Quite true. Observe how amiable I act.
But Reginald, how long will this last?
With occasional intervals for rest and refreshment, as long as I do.
Oh, Reginald, I'm so happy. Oh, dear, dear Reginald, I cannot express the joy I feel at this change. It will no longer be a duty to love you, but a bliss, a rapture, an ecstasy. But, oh, horror.
What's the matter?
Is it quite
continent from henceforth. You are a perfect being, utterly free from defect of any kind.
Quite certain. I have sworn it.
Then I never can be yours.
Why not?
Love, to be pure, must be absolutely unselfish. And there can be nothing unselfish in my loving such a perfect being as you have now become.
But wait, stop a bit. I don't want to change. I'll relapse. I'll be as interrupted.
Waterloo House, Shanghai. A school in Cross, Shanghai. A steady and stolid jolly bank holiday every day, young man.
We're swells and whirls and girls. We're mad and we're weeds and girls. We're quittling, pattering, cheering and chattering every day, young girls.
Angela! Ella! Sophia! What does this mean?
It means that Archibald the All Right cannot be all wrong. And if the All Right chooses to discard aestheticism, it proves that aestheticism ought to be discarded.
Oh, Archibald! Archibald! I'm shocked, surprised, horrified.
I can't help it. I'm not a free agent. I do it on compulsion.
But this is terrible. Go, I shall never set eyes on you again.
Oh, I say.
But, oh, joy.
What is the matter?
Is it quite certain that from henceforth you are a commonplace young man?
Always, I have sworn it.
Then there can be nothing to prevent my loving you with all the fervour at my command.
Why, that's true.
My Archibald.
My patience.
Crushed again.
Oh, Gemma. I am still here. I have never left you. And I never will.
That's true. There's no use denying it.
You're a fine figure of a woman.
Reginald.
Jane.
Ladies, the Duke has at last determined to select a bride.
I have a great gift to bestow. Approach such of you who are truly lovely. In personal appearance, you have all that is necessary to make a woman happy. In common fairness, I feel I should choose the only one amongst you who has the misfortune to be distinctly plain. Oh. Jane!
Joke!
Crushed again!
After much debate internal, I on Lady Jane decide, and she now may take the Colonel Sapphire, be the Major's bride.
In that case unprecedented, single I shall live and die. I will have to be contented with a tulip or a lie.
You will have to be contented with a tulip or a lie. In that case unprecedented, single he must live and die. He will have to be contented with a tulip or a lie. Break the pace of one another to get married, leave the sight. Each of us.